I have the honor and pleasure of introducing today's speaker, Dr. Leo Richards, who will give us the second annual Henry Commager Lecture. Dr. Richards received his BA, MA, and PhD from the University of California at Berkeley and is currently a professor at UMass Amherst. He is the author of numerous books which I will not pretend to list, but included in his works is The Life and Times of Congressman John Quincy Adams. This book became a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize in 1987. Dr. Richards' latest book and the subject of today's lecture, Shays' Rebellion, the American Revolution's Final Battle, provides a complete and new perspective about the Shayites. His recent discovery of and evaluation of the names of the 4,000 people who were involved in the insurrection has significantly changed our understanding of that major event. Now, going back to Allen, this is obviously in honor of Commager. So I'm saying that given Henry Commager's profound commitment to liberty, protest, democracy, and the rights of minorities, today's talk is an excellent way to remember and honor his life's work. Please join me in welcoming to our Greenfield Community College, where dreams become reality, Dr. Leo Richards.
Well, he indicated I'm a California boy, which is true. And this is the way most people learned about Shay's Rebellion, and I learned about it in high school at Berkeley. At least I thought I did. And I said so in the preface to that book. And one of my chums from grade school pointed out, no, you learned it in Mrs. Dempsey's sixth grade class. So the first part of the book has a lie in it, so maybe many others too. This is a story that generally I had learned and others would learn. And it sort of goes like this. For those of you who don't have the background, maybe it'll help. In 1786, the people in this part of the state started shutting down courts. And the first one to be shut down was in Northampton. This was in August 1786. And then a few weeks later, one in Worcester. And then there were about three at roughly the same time where attempts were made. Concord, where they were successful. Taunton, where they might have been successful. It depends how you read the evidence. And then Great Barrington, which is probably my favorite story of all the shutting down. A local general put together troops to defend the court. People are marching on the road to the court to defend it, and then somebody suggests they take a vote. And the general loses 800 of his troops. And so the court really doesn't open. And then there's another attempt in Springfield. During these early attempts, the militia didn't do what the state legislature and the governor wanted them to do. They didn't come to the aid of the courts. And so, in the winter of 1786-87, the governor, James Bowdoin, decided that he would hire an army. And the army would be sent out from Boston, but before they got there, the Shaysites would try to get the arsenal in Springfield. And at that point, there was a militia group that would turn them back by using arsenal weapons against them. And the Shaysites then would flee up to Pelham, and eventually they would move to Petersham, where the state army, under General Lincoln, finally caught up with them. And after that, they flee. Daniel Shays, among others, will head north into New Hampshire and then into Vermont. And a lot of the leaders would end up in Vermont. That becomes the safe haven for the Shaysites. That is the story that I heard as a kid. That is a story I heard as an undergraduate at Berkeley. That's also the story I heard as a graduate. And the only reason I ever got interested in this is I was teaching a course a few years ago, and a book that I had used all the time suddenly went out of print. And so I had to find another book, and in the footnote to the book, learned that the state archives had the names of all the Shaysites. So I decided I'd find out who these people were. And there's some 4,000 on the list. And I'd go through and see if I could learn anything about them. I did. And I decided as I got halfway through that some of these guys just don't fit. They were supposed to be poor debtors, hopelessly in debt, who shut down the courts because they didn't want the courts to foreclose on their farms. It just doesn't really quite do it, because some of these people aren't poor debtors. And so what am I going to do? And more research, I discovered there are more people who aren't poor debtors, and the poor debtors turn out to be a minority. So one thing leads to another, and it finally ends in further research and this book on Shay's Rebellion. The way you tell a story depends upon how you focus. And the state had this choice very early on. In the winter of 1786-1787, they didn't call it Shay's Rebellion. In the winter of 1786-87, they didn't really know what to call it. But the two characters they thought were major in the winter of 1786-87 were Daniel Shays, he's on the left here, and Job Shattuck, he's on the right. And in contempt, these people are referred to as General, that's Shays, and Colonel, that's Shattuck. And so they at times thought that Shattuck was equal. One of the problems with this story was that Shattuck was arrested pretty early on in the rebellion and thrown into a Boston jail. And the thing keeps going on. So if you got your leader in jail and people are still rebelling, it doesn't really work too well. So he will be eventually dropped from the story. But if you had him in the story, as well as Daniel Shays, then you're faced with another problem. If you focus on Daniel Shays, you can make a pretty good case he's a poor farmer. This is a picture of his place in Pelham, taken after the rebellion is over. It is a modest Cape-style farm house. He owned 100 acres. You could clearly argue he's certainly a modest man. You could even argue he's poor. He was in debt at the time. He did owe money to 10 people. What they never bothered to point out at the time, though, is some of the people he owed money to were also fellow rebels. But he is a modest man. Job Shattuck was not. Job Shattuck was quite different. Here is a picture of his house. It still stands. It's on the road between Groton and Pepperell. I remember the time I went to the library in Groton and Pepperell, and this woman who was the librarian, I had a document that said Shattuck was a poor man. And I showed it to her, and she said, "You want to see his house?" And I said, "Sure." And she took me in her car, and we went down the road, and there is his house. And it turns out Job Shattuck was not a poor man. Job Shattuck was the richest farmer in the area. He owned 500 acres. He was also the biggest creditor in the area. And he was the biggest rebel in the area. So if you focus on the Shattuck house, you would get one story. You focus on the Shays house, you get another. When you start to study Shays Rebellion and start to study who participates, the thing that jumps out at you finally is the fact that some places provide a lot of people and others provide no one. Here are where the rebels come from. The counties. Berkshire County, Bristol, Hampshire, Middlesex, and Worcester. I have to explain to you, Hampshire in those days ran from the top of the state to the bottom. There was no Franklin. There was no Hampden. In those days, Hampshire County is exactly like Berkshire and Worcester County today, running from the top to the bottom. And so you can see Hampshire County, including present-day Franklin and present-day Hamden, provided the greatest number of rebels. Once you get into the county, though, you find it varies from place to place. The banner town for rebels turns out to be Coleraine. I usually don't get cheers for this. Coleraine. Coleraine provides 156 men for the rebellion. And no other town really comes close. And given the size of the town, it's quite remarkable. The next town on the list is West Springfield, which provides 141. West Springfield, as you would guess, was a much, much bigger town then. So there were far more people to draw upon. In Coleraine, they got probably 2 out of every 3 males to participate in the rebellion. And then you get to Amherst and Pelham and so on down the list. Then you get other towns that provide nobody or next to nobody. And there's been debate since this book came out over some of these towns. Somebody contacted me and said there were people from Heath. I believe it. And he provides me with some names. And it turns out that's the way it is presented in a local history. So I go back to the library, I look up the document, and all of these characters listed Charlemont as their hometown. So either they didn't know where they lived, or the local historian didn't know where they lived years later. In any event, there is disproportions. There are some towns that provide a lot of people, and other towns that provide virtually nobody. And this becomes part of the story. And then when you start investigating these towns, it is just not the poor farmers who rebel. It is oftentimes their wealthier neighbors. And I'll give you an example from, I have examples from all towns. I should have brought Coleraine, given the applause I got. But I'll give you the one I know best, and that is Amherst. If you go into Amherst and into the rebellion and look at the people who took the oath of allegiance after the rebellion was over, admitted that they participated in the rebellion and promised they'd never do it again. You also look at the people who got themselves indicted and thrown in jail. You come up with about 120 people. And when you start looking at those people, the first thing that jumps out at you is Dickens. Well, living in Amherst for the last 30 some odd years, I knew the Dickinsons weren't poor people. And so that was one of the things. What historians do is they do what is called family reconstitution. You try to figure out all the members of the family. You find out who these people are married to, who their father-in-law was, who their mother-in-law was, and all that kind of thing. You try to get all this kind of information. And if you do that with families in the rebellion, you find that there's not just 20 people who are Dickinsons in the rebellion. There are also other men in the rebellion who are the daughters of Dickinson women who have married into other families. And when you get the grand total, you're talking about 30 or 31 out of 120 or 121. Are all out of the same family. And so it is families that get their people out. Some families get everybody out, but they get them out. And in the case of Amherst, the Dickinsons get their people out. And these are the number of Dickinsons that participate and where they come out of the tax list. And as you'll notice, 12 are in the top 20%. 3 are in the second 20%, 4 are in the third 20%, and on down. And the other rebel families more or less get the same thing. All towns are not like this. Some towns are more even. That is, there is a good number from the bottom as well as the top. But in every town, you find people from the top as well as the bottom who participate. Now, in the case of Coleraine, the participation is so universal, you find every tax bracket involved. They just get their people out. They get out and they fight. So this becomes part of the story. The other thing you notice once you get into it is the number of men who are veterans. When George Washington heard about the rebellion in Massachusetts, there were things that worried him about it. First of all, he was one of the few people who didn't really quite believe it was just over debt and foreclosures. George Washington got his information from two sources. One was a newspaper called the Pennsylvania Packet, which he got in Virginia. And he read about it, and in the Pennsylvania Packet, they did say it was poor debtors trying to save their farms. That's what's going on up there, according to this Philadelphia newsman. That's what's going on. And George Washington sort of believed it. But what troubled him was the attempt to seize the arsenal. That really bothered him. If these people are just poor debtors trying to save their farm, why did they try to get the arsenal? Because he knew that the arsenal was the storehouse of almost all the military weapons in New England from the American Revolution. And he knew that if the rebels had got the storehouse, they would have been better armed than the state of Massachusetts. They would have had artillery. The other thing that disturbed him about the story is he kept getting these little vibrations that there were military officers involved. Daniel Shays, Luke Day, he knew that these men had been officers in the Revolution. But some of his advisors, who were New Englanders, told him to discount this. And he relied on two men who were close to him, who were New Englanders. One was a man named David Humphreys, who had been his aide-de-camp and now lived down in New Haven. And David Humphreys reported that these people were levelers. They wanted to seize the land of the rich and redistribute it to the poor. His other source of information was Henry Knox, who had been his artillery commander during the American Revolution, who was a Bostonian in Washington's mind. And he reported the same thing, that these people are really levelers, that they want to take all the property and redistribute it, that they want to overthrow the state. And so he partly believed that. Henry Knox assured him that the officers in the head of Shay's Rebellion were the exception, not the rule. He would refer them to them as a few wretched officers, and assured General Washington that all the men who had fought under him during the Revolution were really loyal, except for these few. In any event, once you get to the documents, it becomes quite clear that the veterans of the Revolution are turning out pretty heavily in some of these towns in behalf of the Shaysites. And again, you have Amherst. Of the Dickinson family, of those people who were old enough to fight in the American Revolution, 23, 21 did so. And then you have another 7 who were just youngsters at the time. And when you look at the other families in Amherst, you also find a disproportionate number of veterans. You find this in one town after another. So this becomes part of the story. You have veterans rebelling. You also have people with some property who are clearly at odds. Now, trying to explain this becomes something of a problem unless you understand some of the background of what's going on in Massachusetts. Back in 1780, the state had finally written a constitution. And right after the Constitution is written, a number of decisions are made. And the most important decision is what they're going to do with the debt that the people of the state had and what the state had itself during the American Revolution. As I try to explain to students, the way the revolution is fought, it's really fought with IOUs. The army doesn't really pay in real money. They pay in promises to pay money, notes that say they're worth so much in gold and silver. If they take a farmer's cattle to feed the army, they don't pay him gold and silver for the cattle. They give him a note that says it's worth so much in gold and silver, and the state will redeem him someday in the future. Not only the state of Massachusetts does this, the state of Rhode Island does it, Connecticut does it, Pennsylvania does it, all of the states do it, along with the new federal government. So there are all kinds of notes in circulation, promises to pay. And what happens after the American Revolution is the various states have to come to some decision how they're going to pay this off. Now what has happened during the notes, with the notes during the revolution, they all go down in value. Because every storekeeper knows that they're not worth what they say they're worth. If they say they're worth 10 pounds, they're not worth 10 pounds. Nobody's going to pay 10 pounds. Who's going to pay the 10 pounds? And so the storekeeper gives 2 pounds or 1 pound of goods for the notes. They go down in value. So when the stakes around 1780 get around to the issue of what are we going to do to redeem these notes and get some creditworthiness ourselves, most of them allow the notes to be paid off at a lesser value, a much lesser value. They decide what they're worth at the minute and then agree to pay them off at that value. And because everybody has issued so many different notes, and you're not dealing with just 2 or 3, they always decide we will consolidate our debt. We'll bring in all the notes, issue new notes, and promise to pay them. Massachusetts does the same thing. Massachusetts does the same thing. It's issued all kinds of notes. It hasn't paid any of them off. But it calls for all the notes coming in and new notes being issued in their place. And the legislature will decide there should be 2 kinds of notes. One for these army guys who never got paid. We'll call them army notes. And the others for everybody else. We'll call them consolidated notes. And so everybody's supposed to turn in their notes, and the state will issue 2 kinds. One for the army guys and one for the consolidated. And that becomes the system. What are these going to be paid off at? Every other state decides to pay such notes off at what they are worth now, which is not much. What Massachusetts decides to do is pay them off at what they were worth on the day they were issued. That doesn't mean they're worth what they said they were worth. It means what you could get for them on the day of issue. And this is about twice as high as any other state is willing to do. Then the problem becomes, you've got to pay off the notes. And the state legislature, unlike the government today, thinks being in debt is a bad idea. And so the state of Massachusetts, unlike our federal government today, wants to get out of debt within a year or two. And the great goal is to get out by 1790. So this is about a 9-year time to pay off all the notes. It's also decided you've got to pay interest on the notes for the people who hold them. So they decide on 6 pounds. And you've got to pay the interest in gold and silver. But we've got to redeem the notes. What this means is they've got to really tax people heavily to get the money to pay off the notes. They have to tax heavily. They have no choice but to tax heavily. And then you look at the tax system. How are they going to get money? There is 2 ways they did it in Massachusetts at the time. One was a land tax, and the other one is a tax on polls. This is a tax on all males who are 16 years of age and older. They would pay a special tax. So if you were a farmer with three sons, say 16, 17, and 18, or 16, 18, and 20, none of them married, none of them out of the house, you're going to pay a poll tax on yourself and these three boys. You're going to have four poll taxes to pay. Plus, you're going to have to pay a land tax to redeem the notes. The problem is, by 1780, the notes have all gone to speculators. They have disappeared. The soldiers who got the notes, they no longer had them. They got rid of them for whatever they could get. And they have fallen into the hands of people who speculate notes, hoping they'll go up in value. Most of the speculators, it turns out, I live in and around Boston. In fact, 80% of the state debt, 80% of the state debt ends up in Boston, and 40% ends up in the hands of just 35 men, who turn out to be the powerhouses of the state legislature. And also, one of them is the governor himself. I sort of lost here what I had. I think this is it. This is a chart that gives you the names of the characters who put up the money for the state's army. Again, the state's army that James Bowdoin put together was not a militia group. It was a hired army. The legislature was not in session when he decided to do this. He decided to hire an army. And to hire an army, he needed money. And since the state wasn't going to provide the money, he had to get money from some other people. And here are the people who put up the money. The leading man on the list is William Phillips, 300 pounds. This is the same family of Phillips Andover and Phillips Exeter. He's a brother of that group. He has gone to Boston and become a very successful merchant. And now, at this time, he is the president of the state's only bank. He is also a big note holder. And he puts up 300 pounds. And this is real money, gold and silver, that he puts up. The second on the list is the governor himself. He comes across with 250 pounds. And on down. All of these characters, except one, is a heavy note holder. Every one of those group on this list here. Then you have 33 men who contribute between 50 and 99 pounds. What does this all mean in today's talk? What is 300 pounds? With 300 pounds, you could hire 150 soldiers for a month. That's what 300 pounds did for you. So if you want to translate it into today's dollars, that's the kind of thing you have to work with. William Phillips put up enough money to hire 150 soldiers for a month. And so this becomes this story, part of the story. People in this part of the state come to the conclusion that the tax system is unfair, that the money is all going to Boston. They don't like the new constitution. They don't like things that have happened. And there have been a number of meetings before the rebellion that point this out. In these meetings before the rebellion, what do people really want? They want to get rid of the state senate. They think that's a waste of money. Why have a state senate? We don't need a state senate. They want to change the rules by which the governor is chosen. They want him to be chosen by the state legislature. They don't want only men worth 1,000 pounds to be eligible for governor. They want the state legislature to choose whoever they please, but only the lower house to still exist. They want to definitely get the government out of Boston. Every one of these groups that will meet will have that as one of their clauses. Get the government out of Boston. The idea is that with it in Boston, there is too much control from the merchant league. And as a lot of people know, in other states, governments are moved out of the hub city. Albany, New York, Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, you name it. Massachusetts is unique in the fact that the hub city is also the state capital. So this is a general view in the backcountry that having a government in the hub city is dangerous. Finally, what do these rebels call themselves? They don't call themselves rebels. They don't call them Shaysites. That's words that come up later. They call themselves regulators. This is the regulation. Now, in American history, there had been a number of regulations before this. It is a word that comes out of England. It's first used in England in 1680s. It really doesn't catch on there, but it will catch on in the colonies in the 1760s. And it really is traced back usually to North Carolina and South Carolina in the 1760s, where people in the backcountry become convinced that the provincial government is out of control. And something has to be done to bring it into control. In the case of North Carolina, there is this belief that the government is robbing them blind, that they have sent in people to take over the courts, take over the sheriff's office, and they're just taking advantage of honest farmers. And something has to be done about it. And so they put together this group they call regulators. And the governor will bring out troops and put them down very successfully. In South Carolina, at roughly the same time, the problem is outlaws on the frontier. Outlaws who are running wild. And what is the government in Charleston doing? Nothing. Nothing. And so these people decide something has to be done. They got two problems, the outlaws and the government. And so they form the South Carolina Regulators. They, unlike the North Carolinians, come out pretty much on top. They execute most of the outlaws, illegally, of course, and the government finally gives in to them. But they come out on top. The other example that people in this state would always point to at the time was Vermont. And this is the Green Mountain Boys, who in the eyes of people like William Phillips, James Bowdoin, Thomas Russell, Samuel Breck, and so on. In the eyes of those men, all the Green Mountain Boys were outlaws. This was an outlaw regime, as far as James Bowdoin was concerned. And that is because the Green Mountain Boys had led this rebellion really against New York landowners and New York speculators, and were fairly successful at it. Also, Vermont in these years was an independent republic. It was not part of the United States. It was an independent republic. And that is one of the reasons that people like Daniel Shays, Luke Day, and others, when they decide to flee the state, where do they flee to? They go to Vermont. They're in a foreign country, really. Independent republic. The other thing is the leaders of Vermont, Ethan Allen, Thomas Chittenden, would not cooperate with the state of Massachusetts, refused to do so. And so when James Bowdoin turns to Ethan Allen or Governor Chittenden for help, he gets none, none whatsoever. Ethan Allen will refer to James Bowdoin as a damn rascal and operate with those things in mind. In any event, this becomes the background of the rebellion. What makes the rebellion important is that people like George Washington got so nervous with it that they decided that something had to be done. Something had to be done. Before Shays' rebellion, George Washington was happily retired on the banks of Potomac. People had asked him to get involved, to do something about the Articles of Confederation, the first federal government. They're too weak, sir. We got to change them. He refused. There had been meeting after meeting to change the Articles of Confederation. There had been a convention in Annapolis in 1786. It failed horribly. Now there was going to be one in Philadelphia. Would it work? James Madison hoped it would. So he would write George Washington and say, sir, we have taken the liberty of putting your name as one of our delegates to this convention to be taking place in Philadelphia. It is up to you, of course, sir, whether you go. And for months, Washington refuses to go. He points out to people that he had retired, that he had taken an oath of retirement, that he was never going to get involved again, but he has talked him to go. And it's fairly clear from his own writings that Shay's Rebellion is one of the things that talks him into going. He thinks the whole country is falling apart. There are other examples too. In this state of Massachusetts, there was a leading lawyer named Rufus King who represented Massachusetts to the Congress in the 1780s. He's a young Harvard graduate, has been sent down there to do his duty by the state, and people have suggested that he get behind a movement to change the Articles of Confederation. He's been really ordered to do so by the state, by the governor. What takes place is he refuses to do it. He refuses to tinker with the Articles of Confederation. Why? As he explains it, if you start changing one clause in the Articles of Confederation, you're going to have to change another. Because we're not going to get our way on everything here. Those Virginians, they want changes too. And some of the changes they want, we don't. So it's best to leave it alone. Another character who has exactly the same attitude is Theodore Sedgwick. He's a lawyer in the Berkshires, in Great Barrington, doing very well, thank you. One of the richest men in the area. He too does not want to fool with the Articles of Confederation. His reason in the 1780s is the Virginians. The Virginians, he's convinced, want a bigger say in the national government. So if we go in and negotiate with them to change the national government, they're going to get a bigger voice in it. With Shay's Rebellion, both Rufus King and Theodore Sedgwick give up this notion of not tinkering with the Articles of Confederation. Both of them become gung-ho for writing a new constitution. They will become a little disturbed later on when that new constitution proves to them the one thing they had feared, that the Virginians would end up running the country. But that is another story. Leave that for another day. Anybody has a question? Yes, sir.
I'm interested in the list of towns. There wasn't anybody that showed up on their list in Greenfield.
Oh, Greenfield. There are people from Greenfield. What I did there is put the towns with the most people and the towns with the fewest. Yes. So I left out, there's something like 50 or 60 towns in Hampshire County at the time. But there were people in Greenfield, and including people who were indicted. Yes, sir.
Has anybody written a historically accurate fiction based on the rebellion?
Historically accurate fiction?
Yeah.
Not that I know of. Not that I know of. It's hard to do. Yes, sir.
The chart you have up here, now these are people who originally loaned money as the revolution was unfolding.
No, no. This is the people who put up the money to hire the state army. It's hired to put down the rebellion.
Oh, to put down the rebellion.
Right. These are people who put up the money to put down the rebellion.
Does your book contain a list of people who were the major note holders?
Oh, I know who they are. Yeah. These characters here are among them. This guy here has about $30,000 worth of notes. This person here probably has an equal number. These two men are partners, Phillips and Jonathan Mason. And they and their sons, I think, I calculated, owned a little over 5% of the entire state debt. So if the state paid them off, they were going to do well.
So this is an investment.
This is an investment. Yeah. And the general of the army, General Lincoln, he basically goes to these guys and says, you got to invest in it. You have more to lose than anybody else. So put up 300 pounds, you get maybe 30,000 pounds back. Yes, sir.
Do you accept this list of 4,000
had as a complete list?
Oh, no. No, I'm sure there are people who didn't do it. I'm sure there are. You find in the list in the archives, there's people who obviously didn't trust their local justice of the peace and signed up twice. Because every time you signed up, you paid 9 pence. That's what you had to do for you to take down your name. And you find some names that show up more than once. And you know they're the same guy. Because they're, you know, they list the same town. And when you go back to the town records, it turns out. No, I'm sure there are people who aren't there.
Yeah, we're talking now about Shay's followers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, what happens at the end of the rebellion is you have all these people who rebelled against the state. Thousands. And what the state offers them is what we call now a plea bargain. You give up certain rights, and we will not whip you, we will not fine you, and we will not hang you. And what the rights are, you have to give up the right to vote for 3 years, the right to serve on a jury for 3 years, the right to be a tavern keeper, the right to teach school, and a couple other things that escape my mind right now. But anyway, it was for 3 years. That's the penalty. But you had to confess. So you sign this thing, say, I took up arms against the state, and you, then there's a clause in there saying, I promise never to do it again, or something like that.
Poll tax originated at that time. And
oh, no, poll tax is an old tax.
Yeah, but it went on for years.
Oh, yeah, the poll tax continues. It's just the amount goes way down. They have to raise the poll tax sky high to fund the rebellion. It gets up to about 25 shillings per year, which is high for the time. And then later on, it'll drop down to less than the shillings.
We have time for one more question. There's a class that's coming in.
Yes, sir.
Did anyone question the legality of that army?
Did anybody question the legality of the army? No, because the army is backed by people in control. You know, I mean, people out here question the legality of the army, but yeah. I mean, just while the state was not in control, you could argue it's still not in control.